Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we thank you for this occasion of honoring you and cherishing the honor of education and the blessing of these students as they graduate. We pray, Lord, that as you have led them so far to their accomplishments, may you lead them in the future. And we thank you, Lord, for their teachers, for the parents, for the community, and for the world that has brought them this far. But we know, Lord, most of all, you have led them, and you will have a direction for them to continue in this special time in our history, a time to rise for this special challenge and special opportunity. We give you thanks. And we ask, Lord, that you will be with them in this service and this celebration as we celebrate the gift of your love in Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Good evening. Thank you, Cam, for that invitation to a very special event. I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome you to the Sudan High School graduation ceremony of the class of 2020. I would like to read a statement on behalf of the graduates. This ceremony is a very special event in our lives. This evening, we culminate 12 years of study, and we are delighted to have you with us. The members of the graduating class of 2020 respectfully request that parents and guests at this commencement exercise refrain from making unnecessary noises and disruptions. What? Oh, you are at your homes. Okay, then you guys make all the noise you want. Just don't get in trouble for disrupting the peace in your neighborhood. This is usually the last time I get to tell students to be in dress code and put their cell phones up. I am truly missing that. You guys will go down in history because of the circumstances you have been put into, and I can't think of a better group of young people to handle it. I've said before that if something needs done and done well and done differently, then send a Sudan man to do it. I will rephrase this for this occasion and say send a Sudan graduate, because they have come from a very special place that teaches resilience and teaches us to play and work together toward a common goal, a place where you are loved and pushed to become great people. Graduates, you are certainly blessed. Graduates, you are certainly blessed to have had the teachers, community, and expectations that go with being from Sudan. Graduates, enjoy being honored, because it has truly been an honor to have had you all at Sudan High School. I would like to say thank you to a few people that made this event happen in a way that is truly the Sudan way. First, the district teachers and staff that poured so much support into the class through signs and acts of love. Thank you, Mrs. Humphreys, for putting that together for these students. Next, the class sponsors, Keith McCain, Rocky Wynn, Tanya Edens, Warren Swarb, and Wendy Swarb. These folks went above and beyond to make this a very unique event for the graduates. The yard signs and decorations were truly amazing and so fitting. Thank you. Next, I want to say thanks to Kayela, Harrell for continually reaching out to the class throughout the situation to be sure that they met deadlines and responsibilities for things like dual credits, scholarships, and just plain loving them through this. Thanks to LaRonda Hill for making sure things are taken care of, like programs, caps, gowns, tassels, and organization of the event. Thanks next to Jonathan Robertson, Angie Robertson, and DJ Provence for the crazy, and I mean crazy, amount of work with technology items and pictures so that this event could come together. The hours these guys put in alone are so impressive, but the genuine care to give the class the best possible ceremony is absolutely unmatched. These folks, these folks represent consistent excellence. Next, thank you to Mr. Harrell. Because of his ideas and drive to have the very best for our school and its students. Finally, to the class of 2020, your resolve and responsibility to meet each deadline and timeline to make all this happen is truly amazing. Thanks for being here when you were scheduled to be here. Now, go make us proud. We will next have the commencement address given by Pastor Mike Woods of the First Baptist Church. Then the salutatorian address given by Emma Rich, followed by the valedictorian address given by Miguel Melendez.
Well, congratulations, senior class of 2020. Man, I am so honored and privileged to have this opportunity to speak to you this evening. You know, making it through 12 years of school involves facing some very real challenges in life, doesn't it? Some of you more than others, but we all have those challenges and obstacles in life. And as we can testify, there will be challenge after challenge after challenge that you will face out into this world. I'm here to tell you this coronavirus has thrown our world into a time of doubt, confusion, and craziness. And some of you might be thinking, man, I've waited all this time to graduate and get to walk across this stage. But now it's all ruined. Well, let me encourage you with this. We have all had to adjust. And that's what our school has done for you. Mr. Harrell, Mr. Martin, and all the other teachers, staff, are making this time as special as they can for you. But get this. At this time of year, every year, senior class after senior class after senior class have walked across this stage. Each year it's the same, with just different names, different faces, and different speeches. But this year, 2020, is a year that never will be forgotten. You are going down in history, the year of special graduations. You're going to go down in history as the class who had a graduation ceremony that was different than all the rest. And the wonderful thing about being different is that you can use your numerous challenges to establish victories in life. You've already had some victories underneath your belt. If I remember right, man, you've had so many victories through football, through basketball, through all sports, through UIL events, through FFA, everything you've done, you have had victories. Think about this. You've graduated from being born and successfully adjusted to life, haven't you? You graduated from infancy and successfully began that first day of kindergarten. You graduated kindergarten and went into elementary. You graduated elementary, went into junior high. You graduated junior high, and you successfully navigated your teenage years. And now you're graduating from high school, and you must travel the road of adulthood. So how can your continued success be certain? What I'd like to do this evening is look at some guidelines from God's Word that are going to provide guidance for you as you leave Sudan and begin your journey into this world. We've all been there. Your heart begins to beat rapidly. There's a shortness of breath. You have difficulty swallowing. Your knees are weak. Your hands are cold. You've been sweating like never before. And this is what it's like for most of us who give our first speech in life, right? Maybe you're leaving home for the first time and you want to succeed, which you guys are. But one of the greatest threats to success is fear. While all fear isn't bad, everyone knows what it's like to be afraid. You see, when fear immobilizes us and keeps us from doing what we've been called to do, we are dominated by what we call a spirit of fear. This is the kind of fear that paralyzes and keeps us from doing the things that we could or we should. And here's where I'd like to encourage you with this afternoon. I would like for you, to give you your first guideline to success with this thought. Face your fears. 2 Timothy 1:7 says this, "For God has not given us a spirit of fearfulness, but one of power, love, and sound judgment." The Bible is full of fear nots. But I like this verse because it was written to a young man not much older than you guys. You see, Timothy was a young pastor at the church of Ephesus, and the apostle Paul was his mentor. And Paul encouraged Timothy in his first letter not to let others intimidate him because of his young age. But Timothy was afraid of not being good enough as a young pastor. He lacked the self-confidence. So in his second letter to Timothy, Paul reminds Timothy that any fear in his life did not come from God's Spirit. For God did not give us a spirit of fear, but one of power, love, and sound judgment. You see, with God in control of our lives, you can face your fears. Max Lucado says this, "Fear doesn't want you to make the journey to the mountaintop. If he can rattle you enough, fear will persuade you to take your eyes off the peak and settle for the valleys below." Seniors, you might not realize it right now, but living away from home can be fearful at times. Some of you may be thinking, man, I can't wait to get out. I can't wait to get alone. I can't wait to go to college. I can't wait to get to Sudan. But I'm here to tell you there's something in this world that's going to throw at you that's just going to make you afraid, that's going to cause you to be fearful. Maybe it's going for a job interview. That can be stressful, can't it? Making new friends can be overwhelming. But seniors, God has not given you a spirit of fear, so remember that. It's God's will to move you from fear to confidence. You're called to live courageously and to trust in God to work in and through you. God can and will use your life, but you must be willing to face your fears. Maybe it's saying yes to Jesus Christ on a secular college campus is a courageous thing to do while facing the fear of being labeled a Jesus freak. Saying yes to a godly lifestyle and a job is a courageous thing while facing fear of being made fun of. Saying no to drugs and the parties that you're invited to is a courageous thing, even though you may be left alone. Saying yes to being honest is a courageous thing when facing the fear of a bad grade. You see, one of the biggest battles you'll face is a battle for honesty. Dishonesty is rooted in fear. A rancher once asked a veterinarian for some free advice. He said, man, I have a horse that walks normally sometimes, and then sometimes it walks with a limp. What do I do? The veterinarian replied back to him. He says, well, next time he walks normally, sell him. Dishonesty is the norm today. We see it all over the place. And it takes courage to be honest on a resume or not to cheat on an exam, even if you have to stand alone. So face those fears, because Jesus Christ has not given you a spirit of fear, but one of power, love, and sound judgment. So if our fears don't keep us from navigating life, then how we respond to our failures might. So the second thing I want to give you is forget your failures. Forget your failures. Let me read Philippians 3, 12 through 14 to you. It says, not that I've already reached the goal, or I am already fully mature, but I make every effort to take hold of it because I have been taken hold of by Christ Jesus. Brothers, I do not consider myself to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, get this, forgetting what is behind me and reaching forward to what is ahead. You get that? Forgetting what is behind me and reaching forward to what is ahead. Verse 14 says, I pursue my goal, the prize promised by God's heavenly call in Christ Jesus. We see two things in Paul's life here that we can learn from this. Number one, he refused to allow failures to destroy his life. And number two, he refused to allow his failures to affect his journey on to his goal. What was his secret? He put the past behind him and he strived to have a positive outlook on life. Guys, there's going to be failures. You will mess up. You will mess up. As Dad once told me, none of us are perfect, and the only ones that never do anything wrong are the ones who don't do anything at all. It's not a matter of if you're going to mess up or fail. It's a matter of when you're going to mess up. And when we mess up, when we fail, we must learn from it. And we must put it behind us. And we must never allow this failure to stop us from moving forward in life's journey. In the middle of World War II, Oxford University asked Prime Minister Winston Churchill to address its commencement exercises. Dressed in his finest suit, he arrived at the auditorium where the service was to be held with his usual props, his cigar, his top hat, and his cane. And as Churchill approached the platform, the crowd got up and started to applaud him. Standing there looking very dignified, he settled the crowd down and asked them to be seated. So standing confidently before this crowd, he removed his cigar, placed his top hat on the podium. And then Churchill gazed at the audience and the graduates sitting there for a few moments, and then with an authoritative tone in his voice, he said three words, never give up. Several seconds passed, nothing else being spoken, and then he said those same words again, never give up. After that, there was a deafening silence in the room as he grabbed his top hat, put it on, and began to leave the platform. That was the end of his commencement address. So like I said a moment ago, man, we're all going to mess up. We're all going to fail. You're going to mess up. You're going to fail. No matter if you think you're Superman, you will mess up. But you must always continue to move forward, putting past failures behind you and looking forward to what's ahead, and never give up. The last thing I have, to reach the goal that Paul spoke about, you must follow this final guideline. And this is probably the most important one of all, is follow your faith. The big book of Hebrews was written to Christians who were struggling in their faith, and they were wavering in their devotion to Jesus Christ because they were going through some tough times. But the writer here encourages these believers to never give up. Do not give up. And that others have been victorious. And so can you. You can be victorious in life. Hebrews 12, 1 through 3, it says, therefore, since we also have such a large crowd of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every weight and sin that so easily ensnares us. Let us run the race in endurance, the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the source and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that lay before him endured the cross and despised his shame, and has sat down at the right hand of God's throne. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, so that you won't grow weary or lose heart. You see, the writer of Hebrews tells us that all runners need a reference point. They need a goal, right? While running a race. You've been there, you've been at a track meet or a UIL event or an FFA event, whatever it is. The end goal was what you were shooting for, that gold medal, that ribbon, whatever it was. You see, we are all in a spiritual race, and we also need a reference point in life. We need a goal in life. Say you're in the middle of nowhere and have no idea where you are. What is the first thing you do? You find true north. And when you find true north, you know where east, west, and south is, and you can navigate from there. Thus, NASA illustrates this point perfectly. On day 6 of Apollo 13's mission, the astronauts needed to make a critical course correction in their flight. If they failed, they probably would have never returned to Earth. So to conserve power, they shut down all the onboard computers of their craft. But the astronauts needed to conduct a 39-second burn of the main engines. They needed to steer. Astronaut Jim Lovell determined that if they kept a fixed point in their small little window, right, they could steer the craft manually. And that focal point turned out to be their destination. It was Earth. As shown in the 1995 Apollo 13, for 39 seconds, they steered the craft, keeping Earth in view in that small little window. By not losing sight of that reference point, the three astronauts avoided disaster. You see, Scripture reminds us, that we must finish your life successfully. We must keep our eyes on Jesus Christ, the source and perfecter of our faith. For Christians, our reference point is Jesus Christ. You can be flexible on a lot of things, and maybe you should be on some. But when it comes to Jesus Christ, the true north of our faith and his teachings, you cannot budge. You must stay firm. I'm here to tell you it's going to be easy to get distracted, especially that first year away from home. But you've got to focus. You've got to remove all obstacles that's in your way. Tie into a local church or get into a campus ministry that's going to help you navigate life. Remember that there are those who have gone before you who, and always know that they are a part of a great cloud of witnesses that will be rooting for you. Your greatest challenge in life, and this is important, your greatest challenge in life is going to be to follow your faith and to be focused on Jesus Christ throughout your journey. So remember, face your fears, forget your failures, and follow your faith. When you leave Sudan, when you go to college or whatever your plan is, whatever your goal is, focus on these three things. Forget your fears, forget your failures, follow your faith. And I'm going to leave you with this. Behind you are all your memories. Before you are all your dreams. Around you are those who love you. And within you, it's all you need. Congratulations, senior class of 2020.
Administration, faculty, and class of 2020, it has been quite the year. As I sat down to write this speech, I began to think a lot about time. How many times have we heard the saying, time is on our side? Throughout our lives, we have been told this on countless occasions. Whether this be from our parents telling us our freshman year not to stress about making major decisions regarding our future, or from coaches at the beginning of the season. We may not know it, but we often take our time for granted. As seniors this year, it has become pretty clear that time may not always be on our side. It is so easy to focus on getting that medal, banner, or trophy so much that we overlook some of the best memories, life lessons, and connections that we will ever have. Trust me, been there, done that. I've been so wrapped up on what could have been that I missed everything in between. But believe me, there's so much you can learn from that in between. Margaret Peters once said, "Time has a wonderful way of showing us what really matters." We have to ask ourselves the question, what really mattered? Was it getting a sale hole at a major stock show? Was it performing your best during a football game? Or even winning a debate round? When I look back on my time, going up and down the halls at Sudan High School, I can't help but think about what really mattered. For me, this was surrounding yourself with people who have similar interests, finding people that believe in you and have a positive outlook, and jumping at the opportunity to learn something new, regardless of what others think. All of these realizations were revealed to me by the little moments that I overlooked. Oftentimes, we didn't recognize the community that we were surrounded by. We didn't realize who was in our corner. But most of all, we were unaware of what we were spending so much time on. But let's think back. I can recall several instances where we were up before dawn nervously preparing for a UIL event. We spent many hours in the parking lot making sure our show would be perfect for Friday night. Some of us perfected putting on pantyhose. And don't even get us started on the mandatory early morning reviews before the star test. Class of 2020, I would not be standing before you today if I had not taken full advantage of the lessons taught to me through the times in my life I considered insignificant. I challenge you to always find joy in everything you do in your life, the good and the bad. Not only will this produce steadfastness, but it will provide you with wisdom and the potential to grow. Appreciate the small moments because they are what matter the most. Though it is important to set goals for yourself, don't squander your time on things that are out of your control. Focus on the things that you may think don't matter. Those are the things that actually matter the most. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to reflect on some of the times that mattered most to me in my high school career. It has truly been a blessing to get to grow up alongside you all. I've also been blessed to have people in my life who have helped me navigate through the small moments. Mom and Dad, thank you for always being my biggest fans. When I told you I wanted to be involved in FFA, you guys didn't bat an eye, even though none of us knew what we were getting into. Thank you for teaching me the importance of faith, family, and love. Mr. Houchin, you are truly a person that is doing what they are called to do. Thank you for teaching me much beyond the classroom and for instilling within me the values of hard work, determination, and sometimes tough love. Ms. Sinach, Nan, there's no telling what my work ethic would look like without your intervention during my sophomore year. Thank you for being patient with me, all of the farm business practices, and, well, memories. These are the times that I will cherish the most throughout my life. Class of 2020, have the time of your life.
You have brains in your head, you have feet in your shoes. You can steer yourself any direction you choose. The great Dr. Seuss. Before I begin my speech, I first want to give thanks to the people that made all this possible, such as Mr. Martin, Ms. Harrell, and also Mr. Harrell. I also want to give a special thanks to the masterminds of Mr. Provence and Mr. Robertson. It is because of their efforts and hard work that we get to have some sort of ceremony to honor the class of 2020 during this unprecedented time. Now, to the class of 2020, As Juliana would say, quoting the famous country singer Parker McCollum, it's been a heck of a year. Over the years, as we have been growing up and going from class to class, every teacher would warn our next teacher about us. They would tell them to watch out for our class. As the years went by, the class of 2020 was dubbed as special and also as the class that would make history. As this year has shown, we have lived up to these very expectations. I, however, now do not think that the teachers were talking about this form of special. To be graduating during a worldwide pandemic is hard. We were stripped from the feelings and activities senior classes before us got to endure and enjoy. We were not able to compete in our last UIL event or dance the night away with our friends during our senior prom. We were not able to spend our last months of our senior year being able to be together to make memories with each other one last time. We instead were forced to be quarantined indoors and do all of our schoolwork from home. This task, as many would agree with me, seemed impossible as there was no motivation to do schoolwork from home, as many other things such as Netflix, Snapchat, Disney Plus distracted us. However, with some inspirational words from our teachers and also our counselor, we were able to make it through and finish our senior year. On the evening of May 22nd, this auditorium in which I stand would have been filled with the family and friends of the graduates of the class of 2020. There would have been laughter, joy, and tears from graduates' mothers as their babies would have been graduating. There would have been 36 graduates, including myself, sitting in these very seats with butterflies in our stomachs, waiting for our diplomas while we speculate and dream about what the future has in store for us. Instead, on the evening of May 22nd, this auditorium is going to be completely deserted as the coronavirus has manipulated every aspect of our lives. Although it is angering and depressing how our senior year turned out, we had to play with the cards we were dealt, as this virus is bigger than us and means so much more. It is about the safety of our grandparents, parents, our friends, and the rest of our families. I want to again thank the people who made all this possible. Mr. Martin, Ms. Harrell, and Mr. Harrell, Mr. Provence, and Mr. Robertson. From the class of 2020, we sincerely thank you for your countless efforts and a number of hours you guys put into making sure that the class of 2020 was able to obtain some sort of recognition. If it was not for your efforts, we would have just had our diplomas mailed to us. As I now move away from the whole virus talk, due to the fact that I probably owe Mr. Provence a bunch of push-ups for saying the name coronavirus out loud, I tell the class of 2020 to not remember their whole school career and their whole high school career by just half a semester. Instead, remember it through the 8 years of primary school, the 3 years of full high school, and a half year of senior year that got us to where we are today. As I begin to close the final moments of my speech, I want to give thanks to the many people who have impacted my life through my educational career so far. I want to give thanks to the teachers for pushing my classmates and I to another level in order to complete our work. I want to thank the staff for having such a wonderful and clean environment to thrive and learn. I also want to thank them for putting up with my classmates and I's messes over the years and for driving us around to any event we ever had. I want to thank Ms. Harrell for counseling us and for being there every time we rushed into her office, panicked and asking questions over college. I want to thank Mr. Martin for always finding a way to motivate us every day, especially through his famous thought of the day quote he told us each day after announcements. To Mr. Harrell, Mr. Robertson, and Mr. Provence, I thank you for providing my classmates and I with the latest resources and technology. To the whole Sudan ISD family, the class of 2020 and I sincerely thank you. I now want to thank the two biggest influences in my life, my mom and my dad. Mom, I thank you for caring for me day in and day out. I thank you for pushing me, raising me, and shaping me into the person I am today. Papa, le doy gracias por todo lo que ha hecho por mí. Le doy gracias por motivarme cada día y por darme la fuerza de luchar cada día por mis sueños. Gracias a usted, soy el hombre que soy. I also want to give thanks to my two older siblings, Beatriz and Jose Luis, for helping me with my work and being someone to look up to. I also want to give thanks to my younger sibling, Andres, for pushing me to be the best I can be and for having someone that looks up to me. I also want to give thanks to God and appreciate him for everything he has done for me and showed me over the years, for molding me and shaping me into the person I am today. Now, to the class of 2020, with everything from the coronavirus to the side, I share with you a statement that a recruiter for a technical school said that has stuck with me since an ag class sophomore year. He said, "I am not just here to recruit you for my school. I am instead here to talk to you about your future." He then went on to say something that I have thought about for a long time. He told my classmates and I to do something with our lives. He said that it does not matter if we enter technical school or a four-year university or even work after high school. He simply said to do something with your life. He said, "Don't be the person everybody calls hometown heroes just because you cannot stay out of your high school years. Don't be the person who, even after you graduate, still hangs out at all the high school hangouts and goes to all the school functions." He instead said to take the time and think about your future and do something with your life and future. Thank you.
Mr. Harrell, at this time, I wish to certify to you that this senior class of 2020 has met all the requirements for high school graduation set forth by the state of Texas. We feel that they are to be congratulated, and you are invited to issue their diplomas. The class will please rise and come forward to receive your diplomas. Zulima Argumido Rodriguez. Parker Scott Batten. Damon Matthew Boyd. Alexander Day Conley. Adam Michael Edens. Karimi Yamil Estrada. Francisco Flores. Tristan Brock Fred. Cameron Grace Goen. Thank you. Jesus Eduardo Cara. Jesus Huerta Bautista. Abigail Faith Huckel. Joshua Hoyt Leal. Mildred Valeria Medrano Rodriguez. Miguel Angel Melendez. Roberto Procuro Yanis Mendoza. Geriana Jasmine Mendoza. Billy Javier Montez. Christian Jeremiah Montez. Yasmin Isabel Montez. Callan Ruth Netherland. Jesus Abraham Nunez Gutierrez. Emma Elaine Rich. Veronica Hernandez Roa. Rodriguez. Devin Richard Salazar. Lillian Rose Sheffield. Janessa Chantel Serrano. Adrian De Jesus Sital. Lance Preston Smith. Giselle Solis. Alec Russell Stevens. Peyton Brian Tolbert. Priscilla Trio. Marlene Centeno Vasquez. Congratulations, you are now graduates of Sudan High School. You may move your tassel from the right side of your cap to the left. At this time, we will have our multimedia presentation.
She was staring out the window of their SUV, complaining, saying, "I can't wait to turn 18. She said, "I'll make my own money and I'll make my own rules. Mama put the car in park out there in front of the school." And she kissed her head and said, "I was just like you. You're gonna miss this. You're gonna want this back. You're gonna wish these days hadn't gone by so fast. These are some good times, so take a good look around. You may not know it now, but you're gonna miss this." Before she knows it, she's a brand new bride in her one bedroom apartment, and her daddy stops by. He tells her it's a nice place. She says, "It'll do for now." Starts talking about babies and buying a house. Daddy shakes his head and says, "Baby, just slow down. 'Cause you're gonna miss this. You're gonna want this back. You're gonna wish these days hadn't gone by so fast. These are some good times, so take a good look around. You may not know it now, but you're gonna miss this. He says, "They don't bother me. I've got two babies of my own. One's 36, one's 23. It's hard to believe, but you're gonna miss this. You're gonna want this back. You're gonna wish these days hadn't gone by so fast. These are some good times, so take a good look. You're gonna miss this. Yeah, you're gonna miss this.
years old, a couple cane poles sitting down by the creek. Lines in the water, watching those bobbers, seeing that red sun sink. Mama's on the porch yelling, supper's hot. Y'all come and get it. We yelled five more minutes. At 16, it was 12:03, standing at her front door. And Katie's dad said midnight, but we needed just a little more. Yellow light flipping on and off, interrupting that goodnight kissing. We wanted five. I had a few more drops of the good stuff, the good times. Oh, but they just keep on flying right on by like it ain't nothing. I wish I had me a pause button. Moments like those, Lord knows I'd hit it and give myself five more minutes. Turned my helmet in, walked to the 50-yard line. Just the coach and me after we lost 8-10-9. And I cried, man, next time to get in here, I'll have to buy a ticket. Can't you give me five more minutes? Time rolls by, the clock don't stop. I wish I had a few more drops of the good stuff, the good times. Oh, but they just keep on flying right on by like it ain't nothing. Wish I had me a pause button. Moments like those, Lord knows I'd hit it and give myself five more minutes. In 86, my grandpa said, there's angels in the room. All the family gathered round, knew the time was coming soon. With so much left to say, I prayed, Lord, I ain't finished, just give us five more minutes. Time rolls by, the clock don't stop. I wish I had a few more drops of the good stuff, the good times. Oh, but they just keep on flying right on by like it ain't nothing. I wish I had me a pause button. Moments like those, Lord knows I'd hit it. Yeah, sometimes this old life will leave you wishing that you had five more minutes.
Forget the keys under the mat. When childhood stars shine, always stay humble and kind. Go to church cause your mama says to. Visit grandpa every chance that you can. It won't be wasted time. Always stay humble and kind. Hold the door, say please, say thank you. Don't steal, don't cheat, don't lie. I know you got mountains to climb, but always stay humble and kind. Well,
nudge or a chip, and here's why. Bitterness keeps you from flying. Always stay humble and kind. Know the difference between sleeping with someone and sleeping with someone you love. I love you, ain't no pickup line, so always stay humble and kind. Hold the door, say please, say thank you. Don't steal, don't cheat, and don't lie. I know you got mountains to climb, but always stay humble and kind. When those dreams you're dreaming come to you, when the work you put in is realized, let yourself feel the pride, but always stay humble and kind. It's hot, eat a root beer popsicle. Shut off the AC and roll the windows down. Let that summer sun shine. Always stay humble and kind. Don't take for granted the love this life gives you. When you get where you're going, don't forget, turn back around. Help the next one in line. Always stay humble and kind.
I now invite the 2020 graduates to sing the school song.
Lord, on this special occasion where we've celebrated the gifts of education and support and nurture, Lord, we know that you're a God who has cared for these students and these graduates, their families, and our community. And we ask, Lord, as they launch into the world to be your servants, to be your witness, we ask that you would watch over them with your care and go with all of us, Lord, as we go to accomplish your purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.